extend or should it?
Whatever.
Okay.
Well, welcome to the board of the Sonoma Valley Hospital. It is an honor and it's a pleasure to host your meeting here. Thank you for coming and thank you for making this possible. My name is Leonardo Lobato, and I am the executive director of La Luz. Welcome also everybody to today. This is a very special building for us, and as well as the campus, we have our offices on the other building. The La Luz Center started almost next year. It's going to be our 40th anniversary. 40th anniversary. So it's going to be an important year for us. Ligia Booker founded La Luz almost 40 years ago. Her and some neighbors put in the trunks of their car food, water, blankets, and drove to the Sonoma Creek where agricultural workers, immigrant workers, lived. They lived under the roof of the stocks, and they started distributing food. So basic needs was the start, assisting immigrants in basic needs was the start of the organization. And then the group started to grow, and it was formalized in 1995, and that's what the year that La Luz was incorporated. This was an old church, and over there where the office buildings are was a house. And that's where Ligia and all the team worked. And this was the church. So in 1995, both the house and the church were conferred to La Luz for $1. And that was an amazing gift from the county. First from the people who owned both the house as well as the church and the county. Conferring that to La Luz, it was a wonderful gift to the community. So this has seen a lot of people here, a lot of work being done, workshops in the room that you were meeting just me. We have therapy sessions for mental health treatment. And we have not only here but the podium you see is a beautiful place. We have had all kinds of events also. We have English classes here. We have all kinds of things. So this place has a wonderful spirit in that regard of all the people that not only come here for addressing their needs. But also the people who volunteer and give their time for the community, and among them it's you. So thank you so much for all you do for the community. Last time I spoke, it was about a year ago. The first time that I spoke to the board, I presented the strategic framework of the organization. Our mission is. Our vision is a Sonoma Valley with equal opportunity of success for all. We are inclusive, even though more than 90% of our clients are Latinos. But our doors are open to everyone.
And is that everyone in Sonoma County, or do you have
borders? We usually our clients, most of our clients, I would say more than. Are from Sonoma Valley, from Kendall South. However, we don't close that. If somebody comes from Santa Rosa or from Sonoma or even Napa, we don't close that. And for small business support, we're getting more and more people from outside, because the person that is responsible for small business support, yes, his fame is now preceding him in that sense, or his work is preceding him, and we're getting more and more people. Which has been a success. That's one of the programs that has been a success, and I want to tell you about it. In last year, from last year to this year, January to June, we have had 187% increase. small business entrepreneurs that we provide several services. So that is something that we are very proud of, and one of our successes in that sense. So in the strategic framework, the organization has grown and has grown fast, and we are at the point of being able to affect transformational change. Technology is always. So we are now at the point in the growth of La Luz that we can affect transformational change in the community. We have grown so much that we have and we're trying to reduce it, more than 100 programs, sub-programs, and services. And with a staff of 22, it is almost impossible to manage. Some programs are HD in regards to penetration to the community. Others we go. So it is important for us, as I was mentioning a year ago, to focus. And we're focusing on four specific areas. What is basic needs? Unmet basic needs. And that is where there is an overlap with a hospital, which we have had various initiatives with which we have worked together. We have, in all the services for basic needs, we group them in six areas. Healthcare access, mental health care access, food access, income stability, safety and legal, which is immigration as well as domestic violence, and finally housing and shelter. Within those buckets, we have many services. Specifically, just to give you an idea, for healthcare access, we have medical navigation. Our services that we provide here are information, referral, and case management. So people come with their needs, and we provide good information for them themselves to be able to assist, to address those basic needs. If there is an interest in accessing our clients and accessing services that either the county or other nonprofits have, then we do a referral. And sometimes we do a warm handoff. If the cases are complex, then we do case management. And we help our clients through that whole process. to give you an idea, last year, and basic needs is our biggest area of services that we provide. Last year we provided around 2,300 services to around 1,000 unique individuals. And we believe that another 1,000 benefit indirectly from those services. That's family members, people who are directly dependent on the clients that we have. We believe that we are reaching around 40% of the Latino population that is in dire need for basic needs. Our objective is to double it. So our aspiration is very 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 high in that regard. But we are at that point that we can achieve. If we achieve our objective, then we can affect transformational change in the community. Because not having, I know that I'm preaching to the public, not having a basic need will not allow individuals and families to be able to attain their dreams and aspirations to develop, and will be stuck in poverty. So it is very, very important, and that is our focus. And this basic needs has a direct link 40 years ago when Vicky Booker founded La Luz. housing is becoming an issue, a large and larger issue here in Sonoma, both on the cost of rent as well as on the availability for low income. Healthcare access is 15% of basic needs services. Mental health service access is 4% of the services that we provide. So that is the first step area unmet basic needs. The second area is increasing in the area potential of Latino families. And there we have two projects that are beautiful projects. The first one is English as a second language. And around 40% of Latinos that live here in Sonoma Valley, we are an immigrant community in that sense, don't speak English very well or non-well. And it's very important for their economic advancement to be able to speak English. And not only for economic advancement, but also for integration in society, as well as generational integration. Because now we have grandfathers that do not speak English very, very, very well, and their grandchildren speak more English than Spanish. So there's the communication there is also difficult. So English second language for us is one of our main projects. We currently have around 100 students, adults, but our intent is in the future, and this is a dream, this is an aspiration. And that's please don't expect that next year to do that. But we would love to have an academy of 1,000 students in that academy. If we can do that, then we can affect transformational change in our community. With an economic advancement, then we have a second project, which is also a beautiful project, which is small business support, which I mentioned already. Then the next big project that we have that can affect transformational change is the increasing school readiness of young Latino children. Only 13% of the children who speak Spanish at home are school ready, kindergarten ready. So they are already starting the school with a gap, with an education gap. And as you know, once you start with an education gap, then it's very difficult to close that gap. The history is that evidence is that it only gets wider and wider. So the intent of our program is through our parent and child education programs, make sure that the children are school ready, but not only the children, but the parents also, because the parents are the first and most important teachers of the children. And they are the ones we have once a week for 3 hours, at both the parent and the child. So it is the parent that will go back to their homes and be able to teach their children and make sure that they are school ready. And not only that, but the parents, we provide them leadership skills so that they can advocate for the children in the schools. In our Latin countries, it's unthinkable to go to the teacher and demand things. The teacher is the maximum authority, and my responsibility as parent ends at the school door. So here it's the other way around. If you don't go and go to the teacher and demand that they give attention to the child, then the child will not receive the proper attention. We also provide all the resources that are available for parents in that sense. If we can do that, then if we can, I haven't told you about our aspiration. Our aspiration also is that every single Latino child and their parents go through our program. We currently are at 40%. And next year, our objective is to jump to 60%. So it's very reachable in that area. And we have a wonderful group of teachers that come from the community, are from the leaders of the community. I don't know how much just my mind. I get passionate, as you can see, I get passionate about what I know, all the things, but I don't want to keep you up. So those are the key programs that we have. Something that a strategy that ties everything together is culture. And our intent here at Lagunsa, this is a very important part of Lagunsa, and this specific area is to explore and celebrate the Latino culture. The cultures, because there are many, the past and the present. Because we, and not only the Latinos, but all of us are building a Latino community here. And that is something that is important to celebrate and to explore. That ties everything, all these programs tie into it. We are creating a community, and a community not isolated, but a community extended to all sorts of stuff. So that is just a brief review of what I mentioned the last time I spoke with you, and an update on where we are and our aspirations. Again, thank you for coming. Thank you for the work that you do for our community, and we are honored to have you here. This is your home. Please come back whenever you feel. Thank you.
Thank you so much. for the entire community, but especially I would hope that you would, your community would know about that as well.
Yes, thank you, yes, I'm going to look at it.
Thanks again.
Thank you.
Thank you.
My pleasure is all mine, thank you.
Thank you.
Written report is in our pack.
Right.
Yes. Yes.
I don't think we have any comments or anything about it.
If I might, just on the first point, within the strategic plan element here, I guess I would ask my colleagues to press for more work on a description of the what's termed the campus realignment here. I think we need to have more of a plan, and I don't think there is a plan, from the administration as to what this means. So more definition on that. I go back many years ago to when then CEO started talking about something called an outpatient diagnostic center that kind of was talked about occasionally, bullet pointed, et cetera, and the reference was made to a $15 million program, which really caught my attention. But that eventually went on to a $21 million program with a lot of challenges, to say the least, which we're still attempting to implement. So let's not let this concept of a campus realignment get away from us. Let's stay on top of that and learn what that means. So that's my response to the CEO report.
And I would just go one step further.
Until the medical board decides. So by making this amendment, it would allow us to say to somebody, your application cannot be considered until the medical board, if there's any medical action, actually gets that. It does allow that on a case-by-case basis, such as somebody had remote medical board action, did their probation or whatnot, came out clean, and that's done, that the medical staff can review that and decide to proceed. So it allows that, but also gives them the authority to say, whoa, we just read a huge complaint that makes us nervous. We don't want to be responsible for having a hearing to decide what happened at this other hospital. We want the medical board to make that decision, and we'll follow suit. So that's what the purpose of this amendment is to make it cleaner on our end so that we don't find ourselves paying for an expensive hearing for that. So we do still hope for doing to do our triennial bylaws update, but this is something that actually was supposed to go through back in the middle of COVID, and it got stuck in draft form and never made it through all the committees. So we thought that this was a really important one while we were waiting for the review.
second. Those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you all. Much appreciated. Any other votes? So would you like me to move on to you?
Sure.
All right. I don't have a big report this month. It has actually been quite busy. The ED volumes have been much higher than normal. We're actually tracking full 10% above normal now. I heard from our director, Dr. Cusick, this morning. ED volumes from the last month in June were the highest they've been this entire year, averaging 34 a day. We've previously been averaging about 29 a day. So that's actually quite a significant increase, which is great. And our revenue, been here a year almost now. ER doctors are handling it beautifully. They're really good at this, and they are working with the newer nursing director in the ER to put in place new processes for the people through. Certain things like using hall beds, which are plus or minus, but for simple things, they can actually help delays and triage better and whatnot, and they're working to make sure that that's a comprehensive process, not just a, oh, where do we put this person type thing. So they're really working through that, and it'll be great. I did want a quick update on orthopedics. Dr. Walter is with us. He is doing great. If you have not seen him physically, there's a slight setback in that he injured himself the week before starting, actually trying to save some children in a very, very noble attempt with a rogue kayak, but he tore up a tendon in his arm. And so he's had that repaired in his sling. He's actively seeing patients in the clinic. He's very busy. I've checked on him a couple times. We can't operate probably until the end of August, which is, in all things, because they're not a huge delay, so it's going to take some time for him to see patients and get them scheduled and prepare for surgery. So he's the biggest difference is he's not actively in the orthopedic call pool yet until he is cleared to operate. But he's doing great in the office and has been pretty busy, so that's been good. And then I can speak a little bit more about the socially responsible acute care at the Loan Institute if you'd like, since it was a report or you read about it. Did you want me to speak any more about the award from the Loan Institute? So this is quite an honor. It is rated very highly. This, the Loan Institute is a private institute. You can Google it, learn more. But that has taken on to try and create grant aids to encourage hospitals to be social, what they consider socially responsible in the care they deliver. One of the big metrics they look at is the ratio of executive pay to non-executive pay in the hospital. And I think that's one of the places that we do really well is in the equity It also looks at quality, and it does pull quality from CMS. Why it's somewhat different from some of the other CMS rankings is it looks more globally. And so we've talked about very good quality at the hospital, where while sometimes we don't look at it as good rankings, it's because our numbers are too low. So in this case, those scores that often make us look falsely poor because we don't have enough patients in a certain category. This doesn't include those, and so it's, you know, I think in many ways a more accurate picture of the actual care delivered. It doesn't focus on things we don't do at our small hospital. So it's a great honor and something that I think we're all very proud of.
You know, I really appreciate the explanation, especially variance in quality.
Yeah. So it is the same data, but it's not as complete as, say, all the CMS core measures, right? Some of which apply to us and some of us don't. Dashboards before that are on care compare in our state in like three categories because we don't have enough patients in those categories. And that ends up hurting us per se in some rankings, but in this one it doesn't. Which is great.
I mean, you know, number two out of 248 hospitals in California, that's very impressive.
Yes, yes.
And number 10 in the country?
Yeah.
Statues.
Very impressive.
We need to really make sure this gets out to the community. One of the things that came up when we were speaking with the board of health center is that they were questioning the quality of the work that we do. And so anything that we can do to get it in the paper or our website, you know, anything to get it out there, especially to the community, would be really important.
I know Don's working on that, and there was already a great article that followed.
Yeah, that was good.
Yeah,
a couple articles in the paper, of course, it's now press release, it is
Can you guys hear me?
Yeah.
There we go.
That's good.
Great, thank
you. Yeah. Great. Whitney, if you wouldn't mind, we've got 3 seconds, you could scroll to the finance report. And I will be pretty brief, just in terms of the report out from May. You know, May, the month itself, did we did experience a little bit of a pullback. When you compare May to our previous month of April, but if you remove April, which was a big month, especially in terms of our IGT income that we did book, May did kind of come in very similar to kind of our previous 3 or 4 months. We did see a little bit of a depression on the volume side in May, particularly on the inpatient side, as well as, you know, some areas in our ancillary services. I think that the key part there on the ancillary side, we are seeing those volumes come back around in June. And then as Sabrina said as well, you know, our emergency room volume, we were very busy in the emergency room in June, which continues to trend. We were actually busy also in May as well. You know, I think the key in April, we did see a little bit of a reduction in surgical volumes on the orthopedic side. I think a lot of that was one of our existing orthopods went on PTO in May, which caused a little bit of a depression, especially when you compare that to April. Despite all of that, our operating EBITDA actually exceeded budget. And I think that is due to our continued efforts in really trying to mitigate and control costs where we can. Our operating expenses, removing depreciation, came in nearly 10% under budget, and actually that marks the third month in a row where our operating expenses have run under budget by at least 7%. And I just, you know, I know we mentioned it before, but that has really helped, especially during times where, you know, our volumes have been a little bit more softer than we would have hoped. And also, I think it'd be very difficult in a hospital like this, where I think our ability to flex staff is very limited compared to other health systems and hospitals. So kudos to our staff and our leaders to continuing just to keep their you know, eye on expenses and seeing where we can you know, I guess reduce and mitigate as much as we can until we get our volumes back up. On the cash side, we did see a little bit of a pullback as well in cash collections. I think a good portion of that in May did relate to the fact that our finance team moved back over to the hospital, and that was done at the end of May. So between that and Memorial Day, we lost a couple of key business days through that move. So we do anticipate those cash collections coming up in June as well as July. But I think, you know, from a cash perspective, we're coming in as we anticipated a couple months ago. So now I think, you know, as we're waiting for you know, to go live with the MRI project, Sabrina talked through that Dr. Chris Walpick has indeed started clinic here in Sonoma. So those two things will be really big. We did finally hear, just a couple other updates, that our distressed hospital loan has been fully approved and signed off. So we will be getting those funds by the end of next week. And then we'll turn around and then pay down, use those funds to pay down our line of credit. We should be hearing any day from Partnership, our health plan, and our IGT, our rate range IGT program. We're currently in negotiations with them to try to increase our allotment for this next year. We haven't heard one way or the other yet, but we should be hearing any day now. And I think Sabrina spoke to the hospital index, the low hospital index, so I'm going more into detail there. So I will conclude my verbal report. Happy to answer any questions you might have. Yeah, so I do know the survey did happen this past Monday. There were a couple takeaways in terms of some things they wanted us to address. I don't think any of those were material in nature, and I believe we are all set to have a response turned back around to them by the end of this week. So then at that point, it's just getting them to give us the clearance. They did indicate the surveyor that was out here that she did not want to come back on site physically, so we are hoping that once we kind of move through this term, it will be a quick approval. But that the survey did in fact take place, and there are a couple of adjustments that we were making. We should have that response back to them by the end of it tomorrow.
Thank you.
Would you repeat what you said very briefly about the line of credit negotiations? We've got a finance committee meeting coming up on the 23rd. Do you expect to have a recommendation for us from the banks you've been negotiating with?
Yes, thank you, Bill. We do. We have two firm offers, proposals in place. We are still working with U.S. Bank, our current bank. We haven't received any proposal since we have agreed to extend our line of credit, but we will have, I think, you know, just in those two alone, I think have some good proposals to provide a recommendation and a go-forward plan to the finance committee. So yeah, we are on track to presenting a recommendation at this month's finance committee.